Morning, ladies and gentlemen, and this is my honor to present the topic of evolution of multi-lamellar hole on spectral domain OCT. And I have no financial conflict of interest to disclose, but there is an ongoing lamellar hole study in Hong Kong with support of the direct grant from the Chinese U of Hong Kong. And I much thanks my mentor, Dr. David Liu, and my many other colleagues in the Prince of Wales Hospital for their support in the study. First, the lamellar hole is first described by Gass in 1976. And in biomicroscopy, you could see a reddish oval lesion simulating a full thickness defect. And what ski Allen test would be helpful to distinguish it from a full thickness lamellar hole? But many of the time, you can't differentiate well with macular pseudo holes or whether there is a lamellar hole. With OCT, it is a high resolution scan and you could evaluate the retinal anatomy better. And you could distinguish it with lamellar hole, pseudo hole, or full thickness macular hole. And it would help you in understanding the pathogenesis of the disease, and it provides a means to study the morphological progression of the disease with quantitative measurements on the OCT scan. And the lamellar macular hole is considered as a complication from chronic cystoid macular edema, and this is an abortive process of macular hole formation. And the inner wall of the fovea or the inner wall of a pre-existing superficial cyst are effaced by vitreous traction, but it leaves sufficient tissue in the outer retinal layer. And usually the thin irregular center is surrounded by a retina of almost normal thickness, and the edges of the lamellar macular hole will split away from the underlying retina. And in macular pseudo hole, it is attributable to the centripetal contraction of an epiretinal membrane and resulting in fertilization of the foveal slopes. A center of almost normal thickness of the pseudo hole is surrounded by a thickened retina, and the edges of the pseudo hole are verticalized. So this shows the pictures, and on the left-hand side is the macular pseudo hole, and you could see there is an overlying epiretinal membrane, and the slope of the pseudo hole is vertical, and the perifoveal thickness is being thickened. While in macular lamellar hole, you will see the central fovea is irregular in shape, and the central foveal thickness is relatively thin. However, some authors observe that both lamellar hole and the pseudomacular hole would be different, maybe a different manifestation of the same disease due to the epiretinal membrane contraction. And there is a report showing that there is evolution from the pseudo hole to a lamellar hole, which is demonstrated with OCT. So you see this picture that there is a progressive change in the pseudo to a lamellar hole with an intraretinal split indicated by the arrows. The first evolution study of the lamellar macular hole by OCT was done in Fidel Celis, and he defined OCT definition of the lamellar hole with irregular foveal contour, and there's a break in the inner fovea and a separation of the inner from the outer foveal retinal layers leading to an intraretinal split. But there is absence of a full thickness fovea defect with intact photoreceptors posterior to the area of the foveal dehiscence. With the OCT, you can measure the lamellar hole with the calibers in the software. You could measure the central foveal thickness with the thinnest point at the base of the lamellar hole. And it was found that the lamellar hole has a thinner than normal value of the central foveal thickness. And in the perifoveal retinal thickness, you can measure it from the center of the macula, nasally and temporally on the horizontal line. and the mean diameter of horizontal and vertical diameters with the calipers putting on the edge of the hole. And you observe the epiretinal membrane or operculum occur. With these measurements, you can unify and further study the progression of the post-melanoma hole. And in his studies, he recruited 41 eyes with lamellar macular hole, and these eyes were non-myopic. And he documented the best corrected visual acuity, the diameter, and the foveal thickness with a time domain OCT in every 6 to 12 months. And here shows the result. He found that most of the patients had a concomitant epiretinal membrane, and it occurred in 82%. Posterior vitreous detachment occurred in 50% of the patients, and there are two cases with vitreomacular traction. The diameter of the lamellar hole would increase by time, and at the mean follow-up of 37 months, he observed that diameter increases by 40%. And the mean foveal thickness would decrease by 10%. It was statistically significant. He found that there was a higher proportion of patients having an epiretinal membrane, and they had an increase of the diameter of the lamellar hole more than 10% than the proportion of those patients without an epiretinal membrane. And he observed that the mean best corrected visual acuity would decrease by 6%. And the difference in vision is positively correlated with difference in foveal thickness, and it was negatively correlated with difference in diameter. Meaning that when there is a thinner foveal thickness remaining, and or there is a larger diameter of the lamellar hole, the vision would decrease. However, 70% of the patients have their visual acuity remained stable, and 27% then deteriorated. The range would last from 5 to 15 letters. He concluded that likely the increase in the diameter of the lamellar hole would explain the observed visual acuity decrease. And a recent study the second study is by a special domain OCT. And this also included eyes with non-myopic eyes, 34 eyes with lamellar hole, and studied every 6 months. And the results shows that all the patients had epiretinal membrane, and the mean diameter of the lamellar hole, however, in his study, did not show there is a significant change. And the visual acuity remained stable in all in his patient. And he concluded, he found that there is only a weak correlation between the best corrected visual acuity and the thickness of the residual foveal tissue. How about patients with lamellar hole and high myopia? Usually in biomicroscopy, it is very difficult to identify a lamellar hole because there is often underlying choroidal atrophy and also possibly posterior staphyloma. And this is the case in our center. This is a 44-year-old lady. She complained of right eye visual acuity drop, and there is a slight metamorphopsia. And here's the OCT scan, and it shows there is an avulsion of the inner retinal layer, and also there is an intraretinal cyst, but there is an intact photoreceptor layer. So it is difficult to identify the lamellar hole in high myopic patient because the intense red reflex of the thin retina, and often there's coexisting atrophy or underlying scar or choroidal neovascularization. And many a time it is accompanied with myopic retinal schisis. And we all know that the full thickness macular hole is very difficult to close in highly myopic patients. However, there is limited information about the lateral history of a lamellar hole in a high myopic patient, whether there is a progression to full thickness macular hole, and when is the proper time to intervene.
Sorry, Henry, we only have 1 more minute.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
So in this study by Tayanka, she found out that 20 she recruited patients with high myopia, and it is found that only one patient did progress to a full thickness macular hole at for 17 months. So we would plan to study recruit more cases for high myopic patient, and with a serial OCTT scan, we would do more measurements and collect those patients and give us more data on this topic. So in conclusion, results of the mentioned study indicate that lamellar macular hole are properly relatively stable and even in highly myopic patients, and the best corrected visual acuity is usually maintained. And ERM is a very common finding in lamellar hole, and it suggests that it has factors in the etiology, but there are still controversies about it. And the lateral cause of the lamellar hole might not be affected by accompanying macular retinoschisis, but there it needs more studies to prove it. Thank you very much.